Good evening and welcome to the Thursday, June 9th, 2016 meeting of the Northampton School Committee. I'm Mayor David Narkowitz, and we'll begin the meeting by asking the clerk to call the roll of the school committee.
Dr. Thomas Barrett?
Here.
Ms. Bonner?
Here.
Ms. Rebecca Bianski?
Here.
Ms. Laura Fallon?
Here.
Ms. Ann Hennessy?
Present.
Mr. Danny Meyer?
Here.
Mr. Howard Moore?
Here.
Mr. Nappy?
Here.
Mr. Ed Zahowski?
Present.
And Mayor Newman?
Present. Okay, we're going to begin this evening actually with a special agenda item, and that is a recognition for our district retirees. So Dr. Provost and I will move over to the podium.
Welcome, retirees and friends. This is a bittersweet time for you, I'm sure, as it is for us, your colleagues who are staying on. All I'll say briefly is I know you're prepared for this moment. It's difficult to fully prepare for it, but I've had conversations with some of you as the months have turned to weeks and then days, and so I'm sure that you're going out on a very high note. And let me just say that retirees come back and visit me, and so I can assure you that good things happen. It's amazing. Yep. People seem younger. They can be tan no matter what time of year it is. It's a very, very good part of life you're heading into, and I wish you the best of luck in it. We have several retirees to honor tonight, many of which who are not here. So I'll start with those, and then I'll go back to recognize those who are here. So first, we have Denise Houghton, the parent-child home program coordinator at Bridge Street School, retiring after 9 years with the district. Darlene Elizabeth Cunningham, educational support professional and former teacher at Bridge Street School, retiring after 16 years with the district. James McGuire, a custodian at Ryan Road School, retiring after 16 years with the district. Susan Goddard, an educational support professional at JFK School, retiring with 20 years of service to the district. Deanne Sampson, a cafeteria assistant at JFK Middle School, retiring after 22 years with the district. Laura Vichula, second grade teacher at Bridge Street School, retiring after 22 years with the district. Christopher Brennan, associate principal at Northampton High School, retiring after 29 years with the district. Marianne LaRoche, a school psychologist at Jackson Street and Leeds School, retiring with 30 years with the district. Marilyn Smith, a cafeteria cook at Northampton High School, retiring after 31 years with the district. Before I get to the people who are here, do you want to say a few words? Okay, so now, if those of you who are here would come forward, we'd like to present you with a small token of our appreciation. We have a flower arrangement for you and a Northampton bag, which is a fundraiser for the freshman class. So, something to remember us by. First, I'd like to call up Janet Brown, an educational support professional at Leeds School, retiring after 6 years with the district. Susan Moores, an educational support professional at Leeds School, retiring after 18 years with the district. Carolyn Gazzillo, a cafeteria cook at Ryan Road School, retiring after 28 years with the district. And our person with most service to the district retiring this year, Carrie Kamrick, a PE teacher at JFK Middle School, retiring after 35 years with the district. Congratulations. On behalf of the students of the Northampton Public Schools, I'd like to thank you for your service and wish you the best of luck in the next stage of your life. Thank you.
Okay, so we'll now return to the regular agenda, and we now have time in our meeting for public comment. We do have a sign-up sheet, and we have several folks who have signed up to speak. The first one is Jeremy Whalen. Again, I would ask folks if you could keep your remarks to 3 minutes or less.
Hello, everyone. Jeremy Whalen, 214 Pomeroy Lane in Amherst, Massachusetts. I'm also a technology teacher at Northampton High School. I wanted to touch base on a couple of things tonight. The first is that I urge you to, let me see if I can get this right, support the proposal against lifting the charter cap. I think the charter cap, lifting the charter cap would undermine all the great things public educators do within our community and within our state, and it sets a dangerous precedence for individuals or schools that may not have to adhere to the guidelines that we set forth and the gold standard that we set forth as public educational institutions. I also wanted to applaud our robotics team on a great year, and also for their tremendous outreach at going to Holyoke yesterday and next week. We partnered with Holyoke Codes to offer a robotics workshop to boys and girls in Holyoke, and it was a tremendous experience, and I thank them for that. They scheduled everything themselves, and they did a tremendous job. I'd also like to thank, it was on last meetings agenda, in residence for their $1,000 donation. It's tremendous. And I'd also like to thank a student who's in the audience, Elena Frogamini, for helping me do some outreach over the course of this year. She did a tremendous job. If you've seen the NHS Tech newsletter, she was behind that. She kept me in line and focused to get that out to you to keep everyone informed in our community as to the ongoings in our school. And that outreach led to some significant donations. So I thank her, and I thank In Residence very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jared. Okay, the next speaker signed up is Megan Zinn.
Hi, I'm Megan Zinn, and I'm a member of the NHS Northampton High School PTO and the parent of a brand new NHS graduate and a rising ninth grader. And I'm here to offer a quick report from the PTO on the funds we've raised this year and the gifts we've been able to provide the school. We've raised nearly $34,000 since July 1st, much of which comes from our very generous Northampton High School families. The fundraisers have included fall appeal donations that went out with the school directory, grants for teachers, the Eat for Education, Honor Thy Teacher campaign, Valley Gives, the sales of spirit wear, and trans performance. So far this school year, the PTO has invested almost $28,000 in gifts to the high school. These include a projector, nets for the ping pong club, cameras and camera bags for the Devil's Advocate student newspaper, chess sets for the chess club, donations to the class of 2016 and 2017, 30 graphing calculators for the math department, a $2,000 grant to the English department to purchase new books, an artist stipend for an art and poetry project, two lathes for the wood shop, 30 Chromebooks and software and a charging security cart, and software for the tech department. And for the music department, we've supplied funds for transportation to performances for the NHS chorus, including performances at the elementary schools and JFK, new drum heads and other percussion equipment, and sheet music. For the art department, canvas, new potter's wheel, field trips for the students, for the art students to Mass MoCA, and in-school murals. And for the theater department, the Synology Disk Station, which is a data storage system. And final bit of information, the other PTO activities for the year have included providing beverages for the freshman picnic, publishing and mailing the student directory, hosting a teacher appreciation luncheon, and then later in the year, breakfast, and instituting topics for 20, which is a discussion section at each PTO meeting with staff and community members. That's it.
Thanks.
Thank you, Megan. Okay, the next speaker who signed up this evening is Julie Spencer Robinson.
Hello, my name is Julie Spencer Robinson, and I live at 248 Spring Grove Avenue in Florence. I'm the president of the Northampton Association of School Employees, and I have a sixth grader here at JFK. I want to speak in favor of the resolution to recognize the second Monday in October as Indigenous Peoples Day. The NACE Executive Committee unanimously endorsed this resolution at last month's meeting. The study of Native Americans is an important part of our social studies curriculum in several grades, where Northampton public school students learn about many Native American cultures, the importance of Native Americans to this country's history, and the challenges that Native Americans face today. Recognition of an Indigenous People's Day would serve as a meaningful tribute to this important group of people. I would also like to speak in support of the resolution against lifting the cap on Commonwealth charter schools. You know better than most Northampton residents about the financial injury that charter school tuition payments do to our district's public schools. And while many of us live and work with, and maybe we're friends with, people who send their kids to charter schools, this is the first time in Massachusetts history that an educational issue like this will be decided at the ballot box instead of in the state legislature. That's what makes your support for this resolution against lifting the cap so important, because voters will be looking to you for guidance now and in November. Please vote yes tonight.
Thank you, Julie. Okay. So those were the three individuals who had signed up. Is there anyone else who wishes to offer public comment this evening? Okay, hearing none, I'll now move to announcements from members of the school committee. Okay, I'll start with Mr. Baird and work my way over.
Thank you.
Dr. Baird, excuse me, sorry. Dr.
Thank you. I wanted to just briefly talk about the 50th birthday party for Ryan Road School that happened a week ago. I wanted to start by just saying a huge thank you to all the volunteers, staff, PTO, that made that party possible for the kids and for the community event that happened later in the day. And a belated thank you to the Verizon Group and other volunteers that came out to do the spruce up project. The new sign looks really great. The painting job is really nice. And it started, it just, the whole school just seems really, has a nice appearance now on the outside. For the 50th birthday party, the Sarah Madden principal spoke, along with the superintendent, mayor, and our city councilor, Mary Ann LaBarge. It was nice to see a huge sea of these blue shirts. All the kids had their own blue shirt, and it was really fun to see them all. The theme of the speeches really became about how Ryan Road is a true family, and I think I speak for all the parents there that really feel that that is true. You really get the feeling that everybody knows your kid, and it's a really great feeling to have in your elementary school. The kids sang happy birthday in four different languages, representing the languages of the kids in the school. And I also wanted to give a special thanks to Matt Hindle, who is a parent and a graphics designer who designed the logo for the 50th birthday party and for the t-shirts. I think it's a really fabulous design, and you can get these t-shirts still, I believe, if you contact the school. I also wanted to make a plea to the community. They said the school sent a $10,000 fundraising goal to purchase Chromebooks for the school. The PTO so far has raised $8,063.23, leaving $1,936.77 left to be raised. So if people feel generous and inclined, please reach out to me or a member of the PTO to help us close that fundraising gap. And that's it.
Okay. Ms. Hennessy?
Yes, we are finishing or entering the final step of the superintendent evaluation cycle. And so I'm just making a statement that if anyone has any comments, either in the public, community members, any other stakeholders who want to address any issues or any comments about Dr. Provost, you could talk to Dr. Baird, Mr. Zuchowski, or me, or certainly email or call us, or stop us in our meanderings around town.
Ms. Burnham.
Following up on two people who spoke about questions around the ballot about charter schools, There's a meeting on June 22nd from 5:30 to 7 p.m. at JFK Middle School with pizza and childcare to discuss what this means, to learn how and why and what you can do if you are against the lifting of the charter school gap. The MTA president, Barbara Mandaloni, will provide information and insight, and they write, "Come learn about what's at stake for all of us." So again, that's on Wednesday, June 22nd, 5:30 to 7 p.m. to find out more about the lifting of the charter school cap.
Ms. Fallon.
I just want to congratulate all of the class of 2016 Northampton High School graduates. It was a beautiful graduation ceremony. Our very own Zach Dietz was one of the five winners of an Excellence Award. And there's only one award given for a teacher, the Mary Gray Teacher of the Year Award, and that was given to Jeremy Whalen. And his perfect attendance at school committee meetings may have been mentioned. Congratulations and good luck to all the graduates.
Excellent. Any other announcements? I actually had one small announcement I was going to make. You may or may not know that it's Django in June week coming up. I had the opportunity to issue a proclamation at the last city council meeting in honor of this week, June 17th and 18th. There's going to be a performance at the Academy of Music. And as part of that, the founder of this particular festival, Andrew Lawrence, presented me at the city council with this pretty amazing, I'm told, 8-CD box set of Django Reinhardt and Stefan Grappelli, and I said that I would accept it on behalf of the NHS Music Department, and so that it could be added to their collection. So I wanted to sort of publicly acknowledge them at the school committee and thank them, and I guess I'll hand that over to you to make sure that it gets to the music department. So check it out, June 17th and 18th. Some of the best players of this particular type of jazz are going to be at the Academy. So thank you. Okay, I'm going to now quickly transition to use this announcement period to transition to our new graduate and our school committee representative from the high school, Zach Dietz, to make a report.
Thank you very much. I'd like to start off with echoing what Laura said about the graduation, that the ceremony was really nice, and especially I would like to say that the chorus really, I've seen several graduations at Northampton High, but the chorus did a really great job this year. And actually someone who came to see me who had knew no one else at Northampton High said, "Wow, that was a great high school graduation." And if he said a high school graduation was enjoyable to watch, then that is a testament to our graduation. Last week, An Itch in Her Teeth, which was a student-written production directed by Olivia Kahn-Sperling, was performed, and it was a student-written play, and it focused on, I believe it was 14 short acts that focused on topics concerning feminism, and I did not personally get to see the play, but I heard it was really well received, and it was a big success. Also, in theater, there are currently auditions going on for a student-directed production for next year called Proof. Yesterday, I am told that there was a huge activities fair in the gym at Northampton High School. I've been to three of them before. It's very lively in the gym when that happens, and that is one of the biggest moments at Northampton High, because that really is the lifeblood of all the clubs at Northampton High and all the sports at Northampton High. That is how they do all their recruiting, so I'm told that it was a big success, so that is great. I just saw right before this meeting a YouTube video produced by the Students of Color Association at Northampton High School, and Northampton Community Television. And the video is a 5-minute video entitled Systematic Racism, and it is a compilation of interviews of high school students and students at JFK. And they use the interviews to discuss students' interactions with racism, to raise awareness, and also to promote steps people can take in interactions with like racist remarks, someone makes a racist joke, what you can do exactly. So that is on the Northampton Community Television's YouTube page, and I suggest watching it. And moving on, my last update is for sports, and I can say that this is my most complete sports update of the year. So starting off with baseball, the boys baseball team unfortunately lost in the Western Mass quarterfinals, but that is really far to get to the quarterfinals, so they deserve to be congratulated. And the girls softball team similarly lost in the Western Mass quarterfinals. The boys tennis team finished third place in Western Mass, so that's really great for them. And unfortunately, the girls team did not make the playoffs. The lacrosse boys lost in the first round of the Central West Division II tournament, and the girls lacrosse team lost in the Western Mass quarterfinals. Track, I spent a while trying to look what track finished, but they have so many meets. What I can tell you is that Nicholas Smith, who is a sophomore, set a record at the Central West Division I championships in the 200 meter dash. And I know he's going to be running at the national tournament in a couple weeks. So that is very exciting, representing Northampton High. And lastly, a sport near and dear to my heart, Ultimate Frisbee. The girls team finished third at the state tournament, and the boys team set a record for Northampton High. We finished second, so that was really exciting to get into the state finals. And that concludes my last update for you guys. Thank you all very much for doing what you do for our school system.
Thank you very much, Zachary. Okay, so we now have several recommended actions on our consent agenda this evening. We have the approval of minutes of the negotiating subcommittee for May 11th, May 16th, May 18th, 2016. The Rules and Policy Subcommittee of May 19th, 2016, and then again the Negotiating Subcommittee minutes of May 23rd, 24th, and 25th. You guys meet a lot. And then we have the field trip request, one this time. It's the Jackson Street 5th grade going to the Connecticut Science Center in Hartford, Connecticut, June 13th, 2016. And I would accept a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Motion to approve the consent agenda.
Is there a second? Seconded by Dr. Baird. Any, no discussion. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so the consent agenda is approved. Next, we have, again, another in a series of our recognitions from our various school buildings. And tonight, we will hear from Brian Lombardi with a recognition for Northampton High School staff. So I'll recognize Principal Lombardi.
Good evening. Thanks for having me. I have a video. I'm not going to do much speaking. I'll let the video speak for itself. So if you would kindly turn around or come to the side.
Guess what's going on.
You want us to subtitle
the video? I love this school. This school is great.
Yeah.
deserve that praise.
Top of my list of what was great about the high school are the professionals we have in this building. From the secretaries, custodians, to the teachers, to the ESPs, they all make this place special. For any of you that were at the graduation this past Sunday, some themes you heard was about acceptance, respect, excellence, qualities that I believe make our educational process accessible to our students.
I know that a lot of the teachers that I've had personally stay after school with me just to make sure I understand everything, and their availability is outstanding.
What happens every single day is that we offer educational opportunities. As you can see behind me, hundreds of opportunities for our students to excel in electives, academics. We offer 30 plus clubs and activities and 26 sports. That all comes from dedicated professionals giving their best and giving their time and their energy to our students, going above and beyond the call of duty.
Specifically math, I struggle a lot with certain topics. So when I can get extra help, it's really helpful. And so all of the math teachers that I've had have helped me after school and during class, and we've had a lot of one-on-one time.
I can guarantee you there's not one person in this building that sticks to a time clock of when something's done. What they stick to is, when is the student done? Has the student had their needs met? What can we do to make this the best opportunity for our students? That is Northampton High School, and that is what makes this special today.
I think mostly just like their willingness to engage with students on like a more individual level, where like compared to just like having lectures every day and stuff, and like being very like distant with students. I think definitely the individual connection is important, and I think that's what I'll remember most.
I figured that was much better than the PowerPoint that I had. Any questions?
Any questions for Mr. Lombardi?
Okay. Comment.
Any rebuttals,
comments?
Zach?
Yes.
But your remarks at graduation were lovely, and
thank you.
Really appreciated them.
Okay. Thank you.
See you in 3 minutes.
Okay, so the next item on the agenda is a vote on the presentation of the NEF Small Grant Awards, and I believe Dale Melcher is here from the Northampton Education Foundation to make those presentations.
Thank you. I'm Dale Melcher. I'm on the board of the Northampton Education Foundation, and I chair one of our two grant program committees, the Small Grants to Teachers. I believe you all received the list of grants. I would like to note that we received 22 applications for grants this year for a total of nearly $63,000. Needless to say, we did not have $63,000 to disperse, but we were very excited about the interest shown in the grants this cycle. And just want to note that the need is great. Teachers want to do things, and we want to help make those things possible. This year we also had a fully online application so that teachers could just fill out their application online and submit it. No more making copies, no more killing trees. And finally, I'd like to thank School Committee member Laura Fallon, who serves on the board for the school committee and who serves on the small grant committee. And she was hugely helpful in sorting through all of these grants and helping us to evaluate them and understand how they fit into district priorities and where they filled holes and things like that. So thank you, Laura. So at our May meeting, the Board of the Northampton Education Foundation approved funding of $30,774. We just could not cut $774 out of our grants to 11 applicants for the spring 2016 cycle, which covers all of the next school year. And I'm going to just briefly name them and then ask that you accept this gift from the Northampton Education Foundation. The first one goes to Ryan Road School for a kindergarten outdoor classroom, $2,500. The lead teacher was Andrea Gito, as you can see, other teachers, to support the creation of an outdoor STEM activity space available to all kindergarten students, but particularly important to students with concentration challenges. The second grant went to the Florence Heights Community Engagement Project. This is year two of this project. The lead teacher is Rachel Ellis, and it's a community engagement and literacy project in the Florence Heights complex. Again, another Ryan Road grant. The third one goes to the Leeds School Community Outreach Program, another year two grant, and another community outreach program. And this program is designed to create a supportive educational collaborative between students and their families from Meadowbrook Apartments and Leeds Elementary School. Sorry about the bad grammar there. The fourth grant goes to JFK, year two of the JFK Technology Conference, something that is also supported by the NEF Endowment Grant. And this is a two-day intensive tech conference open to faculty and staff. Grant number five, theater outreach to the high school, to Stephen Eldridge. We're very excited about this project. They will work with a consultant to involve students from every part of the theater program in developing productions that can tour and perform for other schools in the district and possibly around the state and compete in the Massachusetts Educational Theater Guild competitions. The sixth grant is for Jeremy Whalen for a 3D modeling CNC, Google it, I did, STEM boot camp, which is very exciting about getting students to work with computer-assisted design and really make use of the 3D printers that they've acquired. Grant number seven, for all the elementary schools, funds year two of a math recovery book group led, the lead teacher is Mary Cowie. Again, this is to support teachers in really working to implement math recovery and to help each other to design curriculum materials that they can actually use in their classrooms. Grant number eight, very long title, Arts Integrated Curriculum Enhancement for Language Learning Disabilities Students. The lead teacher was Michelle Carmall. Arts Integrated Curriculum Enhancement. This is basically to work with Enchanted Circle Theater, another wonderful contributor to our school system. On two different projects, Reading Alive and From Page to Stage. Grant number nine goes to Northampton High School and JFK, Life in a Changing Climate. The lead teacher was Kate Parrott. Science teachers from both the middle school and the high school will partner with Mass Audubon's Arcadia Wildlife Sanctuary to engage students in really understanding the impact of climate change on our local environment. The day we met, there was a front page article on the Gazette about this program. Very exciting. Grant number 10, Development Techniques for Students with Severe Sensory Challenges. This is the high school, the middle school, and Jackson Street School. The lead teacher is Linda Monshine, and it creates a program for the growing body of students with severe sensory challenges, with training for staff on dealing with sensory integration techniques and creating spaces at these three schools for the students to work. It was really hard for us to make these decisions. We would really like to be able to fund all the worthy projects that are put before us. To that end, we are increasing our fundraising activities, and our ask to you is not for money, but for you to help us let the community know how important the NEF grants are to teachers and staff in the system. The Students of Color video was an NEF-funded project, and we would really like to make sure that anything that NEF contributes to, we get recognized for, so that when we go to the community and ask for more money so that we can say yes to more teachers, that the money will be forthcoming. So I am asking the school committee to accept this, these gifts from the Northampton Education Foundation.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dale, and thank you to NEF for all the work that they do. I would ask our member rep on the board if you'd like to make that motion.
Sure. I move to accept, see the small number? Oh, it wasn't on there. Okay. Move to accept the NEF Small Grants Awards with gratitude.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any further comments or discussions? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so they are gratefully accepted, and we certainly take your request about making sure that we spread the word about NEF and acknowledge at every opportunity the programs that you've helped create. So thank you. Thank you. Okay, the next item on the agenda, speaking of NEF, we have Jason Berg, who's here to present and seek our vote on the NEF Endowment Fund Awards.
This year, the NEF endowment grants, we gave out six endowment grants totaling $48,683 for the school year 2016 to 2017. If you include the multi-year grants we're now funding, we're funding for a total of $78,683 this year. Just to quickly run through the ones that we've chosen to fund this year, the first one is Integrated Math, which is at Northampton High School, and it supports the integrated math teachers to make a library of different curriculum that they can switch between for students to hopefully be more effective. Second grant was for the Bridge Street After School Enrichment Program, and we're trying to start it up. We have a couple of very excited parents, Lori Shine and Jennifer Derringer, who are heading that up for us. The third grant is elementary school 3D printers for all four of the elementary schools, and hopefully it will help with the enhance the STEM programs at those schools. Last year we funded the Energize Northampton for all of the elementary schools, and this is another project along those lines. Fourth grant is the sixth grade social studies grant, which is going to bring some Chromebooks and online subscriptions into the library at JFK here. And the librarian, Gilana, will be working closely with all the sixth grade social studies teachers to make use of those. Responsive Classroom is going to be supported at Jackson Street through Gwen Agnew. And we're hoping that this program can help their school. Safe Passage is piloting a program at the high school this year to try and get a program going there on a more permanent level. The Say Something is the campaign that they're trying to get into the school right now, and we're funding that one. And then the two grants that are multi-year grants are the Outdoor Garden Grant, which supports all of the elementary school's garden projects, and Caught Off Guard, which is a high school project. We're hoping that you will accept these recommendations, grants.
Okay. Did you want to?
Move to accept the NEF Endowment Fund Awards, once again with gratitude.
Second.
Okay, there's been a motion made and seconded. Any comments about these? Dr. Baird?
So just really briefly, just another thank you. I ran into a teacher the other day who was so excited at their rejection. And I thought that was very interesting. But you know, obviously disappointing not to get funded, but they were so encouraged by the letter that came with it saying, we still think this is a really valuable project. please submit it again. So I was really encouraged by that. And so it's kind of unique to be excited by a rejection, but I just thought I would mention that.
Thank you. Any other comments? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Again, thank you again, NEF, and gratefully accepted. Okay. The next item is a report from the Rules and Policy Subcommittee. Actually, rule changes or proposed rule changes, policy changes. The first is the Rules of Procedure Revised. I believe that's a first reading. And then, well, I'll turn it over to the chair.
Yeah, so these are both going to be first readings. We won't be voting on them tonight. We'll be voting next meeting. The first policy is the Rules of Procedure. The changes that are being proposed are based upon recommendations from the school committee's legal counsel and upon a student petition to establish a student union at Northampton High School. And essentially, it's under Section 5, where we have added in, should I read these for the public? Or
you certainly can, sure.
Okay. We've added in Section 5.1, the Student Advisory Committee shall consist of 5 student representatives elected by the student body of the high school, either directly or by the student government. 5.2, the representatives of the Student Advisory Committee shall, by majority vote, prior to the first day of June in each year, elect a chairperson who shall serve for a term of 1 year. Section 5.3 that would be added in is the chairperson shall be an ex officio non-voting member of the school committee without the right to attend executive sessions unless such right is expressly granted by the school committee. The chairperson shall be subject to all school committee rules and regulations and serve without compensation. And then 5.4 would read student advisory committee representatives may be seated one on each of the subcommittees. These students will have the right to discuss issues but not make motions or vote. The only other changes to that document were on page 7, and it was under section 19 minutes. It more closely reflects open meeting law. The part that was added is minutes will be kept in succinct form and shall include the date, time, and place of the meeting, the members present or absent, the decisions made and actions taken, including a record of all votes, a summary of the discussions on each subject, and a list of all documents and exhibits used at the meeting. And I know our subcommittee, we had asked for some input from the high school students who were interested in forming the student union, and I think that they've joined us tonight to discuss it, so.
Okay. So, Lucy, if you could just identify yourself and to all your members also identify themselves when they speak.
Yeah, so my name is Lucy Norton. Student at NHS. This is Sam Buell, also a student, and Elena Fragamini. We are members of the very newly formed student union at Northampton High School. We just want to talk to you guys briefly about what we hope to be and accomplish, hopefully. So we're brand new. We just had our first meeting this morning. But we're very excited and ambitious to hopefully make this an effective means to form a bridge between us students and our concerns and administration and perhaps you guys when we have a representative to the school committee. Again, it's early, but our goals are basically to represent the concerns and sentiments of our peers at the high school. And again, to communicate and coordinate with our administration. So we hope to address issues that we think are important and perhaps that you guys think are important too. So just briefly, currently there are 12 of us, four from each grade, and hopefully there'll be 4 more coming in for the next freshman. And we have yet to vote on officers. So do you guys want
Tuesday.
Next Tuesday, yes. So do you guys want to add anything?
Unless there's any questions.
Yes, if there are any questions, that's
any questions from the school committee? I guess, sure, yes.
Wait, is there student government at Northampton?
Yes, this is separate from the student government.
How is it going to be different than the student government?
Yeah, you're welcome to.
So my name is Lena Frogmini. I was part of forming the student union. One of the things this came out of is for the past years at NHS, we've had a student government body whose primary role has been to fundraise for prom, for graduation, and there's been some kind of like misconceptions about what role that student government fills. So part of what we wanted to do in creating the student union was have a body that truly functioned as a student government, intergrade, addressing the concerns, the sentiments of the student body as a whole, where the class officers operate for each grade in fundraising activities. Does that answer?
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions? Ms. Fallon.
So when would you hope to hold the elections for the incoming freshmen? Have you not gotten that far?
Yeah, so incoming freshmen will have elections when they have their class officer elections, which is typically in the first weeks of September, maybe October. So it'll typically run like freshmen are elected in September when they come in, and the upperclassmen and like the rising sophomores are elected in the spring.
Oh, sorry, Dr. Provost, sorry.
I just want to ask this question for clarification because I don't think it's been discussed yet. When Mr. Lombardi explained one of the functions of the student union to me, he said that it was your desire that the advisory council be essentially elected from among the student union members. Could you just talk a little bit about how that would work?
Our main thing is that because we are elected by our class, we felt that because we are elected by our class, that we should be able to elect a member that has also been elected by the class to serve on the advisory council, for a basic.
And also, if I may add on, part of that is having like a streamlined and unified message between the kids who are representing our student body as a whole and the kids who are representing the student body on the school committee, just to make sure that our students know who their representatives are on the school committee so that they know where to address their concerns. They know that those concerns are being heard by a body that is greater than themselves.
I just want to add one more thing.
No, go ahead, please.
We also hope to assure you that we are very much representing our peers. We hope to have perhaps biweekly meetings or monthly meetings with our peers so that they can voice their concerns, sort of, I don't know, a nag session, if you will. I just wanted to add that.
I just want to applaud what you're doing. I think it's great to have more dialogue and the only thing I still don't fully understand is, so the state law says that there's supposed to be a student advisory committee that's elected by the students, and so your student union, is it basically going to be the student union and student advisory committee?
So what happened, our election day was just a few days ago on Tuesday, and what happened there was that there was a list of kids who are running for student union, a column to check for kids who are running for student union, and a column to check for, out of those kids, who you wanted to be on your student advisory council. So I know we haven't fully counted the ones who would be on student advisory council yet, but the kids from the student union within those kids will come a student advisory council, so out of the 12 members of the sophomores, juniors, and seniors.
I understand.
We're figuring out too.
Right. Yeah. So then the student advisory committee is sort of a subset of the student union.
Yeah, it's like a subcommittee.
And what's the advantage of that? Because it sort of sounds almost like an electoral college that then elects the, you know what I mean? As opposed to just while you're having the election for your class officers and your student union, also have an election for student advisory committee?
The election for student advisory committee was held on the same day as the election for the student union. They were elected directly from the candidates for student union. So it is very clear to the people who are checking the boxes who they're voting for student union and who they're voting for student advisory council. One of the other factors in this was we were aware that kids at NHS are really busy. And gathering a whole extra 5 students that was completely separate from that student union
we might not get kids who would be able to show up all the time or super informed about what's going on in the student union. So I think having our student advisory council elected from the student union provides a streamlined message, as well as an ease in informing the students of who their representatives are, as that was really clear on the ballot. Is there anything else?
Do you want to answer your question? Okay.
I'd also like to add that I think what is great about this, not only was this student driven when they came to me in the early spring, in a desire to be involved and have a dialogue with administration, I think it makes the role of what the advisory was meant to be. Zach's done a great job, don't get me wrong, and I imagine if Zach was in school, he'd be part of this. I think the hard part for Zach and the advisory before, there was no connection with the student government. There was no mandate. It was just it was an elected thing, and it was out there floating along. So Zach really had to do a lot of coordination with the members and really do a lot of, you know, almost like a journalist out there beating the street trying to get information. We're creating now a mechanism in the school by the student to, you know, today our meeting was talking about how are we going to meet on a monthly, we're going to set a monthly meeting for ourselves talking about things. They're going to have monthly meetings themselves, a similar format to a school committee or other where it can be open public comment for students to show up. They're going to create these avenues to elicit student feedback, student comments. They're going to debate them themselves and bring things to me. We'll talk about that. So when you have a student here from this student union, advisory, you're going to get really authentic, genuine aspects of dialogue. You'll get the reports, you'll get the journalistic stuff, but you're also going to get some people that are going to be hearing things directly from the students. And I think that really is what the nature of the advisory is supposed to be. And I think this is the best and most efficient way of getting that out to you guys and having a dialogue between the entities.
Ms. Buzanski?
How do you decide which students sit on the school council?
Well, people put in interest, and we had a ballot. Mm-hmm.
School council is different.
Well, school council, this past year you had a student from each grade.
Yeah.
Oh.
On this tool.
So school council, which I've served on this past year, is separate from the student union.
Yes.
It is, you submit a letter of intent at the beginning of the year. It's one or two students from each grade, depending on how many people submit letters. So that's a separate part.
Got it.
Totally
different.
Yeah.
I'm gonna.
Any other questions?
Oh, sorry. Go out on a limb here. It also says in the state law that we're supposed to meet, we, the school committee, are supposed to somehow interact with the student advisory committee, I think once every 2 months. And so I'm not suggesting that we figure out how to do that tonight or whether your representative does that, but I'm just gonna sort of throw it out there that I would be open to having a discussion at some point of whether there's a way that we can improve that, or maybe we have a liaison from the school committee that meets with a student advisory committee or council, or, you know, just maybe something to think about down the road.
I think that's a terrific idea. Perhaps we could have a liaison come to one of our meetings, or the student, again, like we have a student advisory council representative from our student union coming here, so hopefully, are you thinking that would be different than simply meeting with you guys?
I don't know, I'm just,
yeah, just
like the law says this thing is supposed to happen,
yeah.
And I sort of want to find a way that we make sure we're complying with that, and then also making sure that you feel heard and are included.
Thank you, yeah.
Any other questions for the students right here? Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for all your work on this. So so we're still, so rules of procedure, any other comments or questions about that?
I don't think so. I have to say that the idea of a liaison, I know, serving as liaison for the Northampton Prevention Coalition and the NEF, I guess it's useful in that during meetings, a lot of times they have questions about what is allowed, what is the reason for this, what's for that, and it actually streamlines the process so that by the time it does come to committee, those questions have already been addressed. So I think that does make sense. I don't know who on the committee has time to go if it's a early morning meeting. Like, I think it would be tough to figure something like that out, but I think that that's an interesting idea. But that's all I have to say.
Okay. So that's item one. You have another report for policy KF.
Yes. Next, we have the first reading, there will be no vote tonight, of policy KF, community use of school facilities revised. These changes reflect the creation of a new user category for activities that are sponsored by the Northampton Parks and Recreation Department, but are provided by a third party. So if you are looking at the document on page two, the building use rates, add a column. So you would now have added D, column D, activities sponsored by the Northampton Parks and Recreation Department provided by a third party for commercial purposes. And it is pretty much a flat fee of $10 an hour for building use. And I think that that was the only change other than rewriting category B, C, and E. Users will be required to furnish proof that they have suitable liability insurance policy covering any and all claims, and a typographical error that was changed on the last sentence of page six.
Okay. Any questions or discussion about this? Yes, Mr. Meyer.
So does commercial purposes exclude nonprofits? I'm just trying, I'm wondering about, for instance, Northampton Soccer Club is a nonprofit. If they were to use the field or facilities, would they fall into this category? Because it seemed like the example that motivated the change was a slightly different animal.
So the policy is really intended to address the issue of groups that otherwise would fall into one of the categories under our policy. So nonprofits can fall under different categories under our policy depending on who they serve. So this is really meant to be very limited to groups that have a commercial presence outside of, you know, for example, serving the Northampton Public School students to provide a soccer program or that type of nonprofit. I mean, technically, some corporations could be nonprofit corporations, but I think the key term in this policy or proposed policy is commercial.
That's what I was just trying to figure out what that would capture. So, thank you.
My question is the other half of D, which is sponsored by Northampton Parks and Recreation Department. What about other? Is there any possibility any other department would be sponsoring such a? Activity provided by a third party for commercial purposes?
Another city department?
Then it would be the same question, but it would have this little detailed difference.
I don't think I can recall a time when another city department has brought a commercial group into the schools.
I think the school department does.
The school department might
routinely. So that's the...
That would be the only one that I would wonder about who is for commercial purposes and which wouldn't fall under the other categories. In other words, it would still leave we'd be revising it to fix one thing, but there might be a similar thing out there.
I just want to say I'm not a fan of this. I don't support it. I gave you some information about the Parks and Rec Department just because I want, just for informational purposes. First is their budget. Proposed for FY 2017, it basically shows you what their operating budget is for the year. $221,000 is what we fund the entire Parks and Rec Department with. There's more funding at this table than there is for the entire Parks and Rec Department. Basically, you have staff that run the programs and organize the programs. And then you'll notice that about $84,000 of their funding is from revolving funds, which is basically the fees that they collect when they run the programs. So that helps supplement all of the programs. And it is true, the Parks and Rec Department does contract with outside companies to provide many of these services. One of the ones that's being referred to in this policy, if you turn to page, I don't know, are they numbered? Page, seven, the Playwell Lego programs. Playwell is an I guess it would be considered a company or a business, but they are providing these robotics programs that Parks and Rec is offering. Robotics using Lego, pre-engineering with Lego, engineering fundamentals with Lego. So these are programs that the Parks and Rec Department doesn't have staff that could provide them. So they work out a contract with one of these providers, and they basically say, how much will it cost to, you know, per student to provide this service? And then they, the Parks and Rec Department takes an additional, I think it's $20 per student fee, which they use to then pay for, you know, the cost of administering the program, putting out the brochures, doing the registration, handling all the money, and they just pay the company a flat fee. So I guess I would say, while it's true that, you know, by the letter of this rule, which again only focuses on the Parks and Rec Department, it's provided by a third party, it says for commercial purposes, but most of the programs that's in this booklet are not being provided by staff of the Parks and Rec Department. They're being paid for by somebody who's just being brought in and paid. You know, many of you have probably, your kids may have taken Bardo's soccer clinic that he does every summer at JFK. Brad McGrath, I guess he's a former coach here. You know, him and his team get paid by the rec department for that week or two of the soccer camp that he runs. They're not on the payroll, so I guess they're an outside contractor. He's not a nonprofit. So, I mean, I don't know. So I guess the concern is that pretty much every one of these programs, whether it's the aerobics instructor, the swim aerobics instructor, or even some of the youth coaches, or you know, we talked a little bit in the subcommittee meeting about Mr. Riccardi, who comes in and does the Bird of Prey presentation. We pay him. He does that all around the valley. So one of my concerns is, well, first of all, that it's just focused on the Northampton Parks and Rec Department. And then number two is, while it's discussing certain, you know, mad science I know has been discussed, my concern is just that, can the policy then be expanded to cover virtually every program? And, you know, my other big bugaboo about it is that it's basically, these are all city buildings, and the city provides the funding to the school department to operate and maintain them, and Parks and Rec is a city department. So in some ways it feels like we're just taking money out of one pocket and moving it over to another. So that's my other concern, which I've expressed, and I've made that clear throughout the process. So those are the concerns that I have about it. And I do think that the school department, for example, whether it's the yearbooks or the school rings or the college board, I know that the YMCA, which again is a nonprofit, but it runs a full-scale, you know, before-school daycare program at the schools. I don't know if we charge them rent for the building when they do that. So again, it's kind of a fine line. They're a nonprofit, but they're certainly making a profit. And they're not paying to rent the facility. So those are the concerns that I have about it in terms of why just the Parks and Rec Department. And again, it's, you know, using this room during the summer, it's providing a service to kids and families at an affordable price. It's a camp, so, you know, it's a week during the summer when a parent needs a place for their kid to be. It's a learning experience, we think. And it's a room that's not going to be that's not being used during the summer. And there's staff in the building. There's already custodians here that are working a 9-to-5 or whatever, 7-to-4 shift, whether or not this room is in use or not. So those are the concerns that I have. Any other questions or concerns? This, again, just first reading. Okay.
I am sort of wondering about, so is this expected that these, whatever, four or five categories cover all of the other uses, or, because it seems to me there might be some additional uses that actually aren't within this. I was thinking the Ward 3 Neighborhood Association meets in the Bridge Street School. It's, you know, it doesn't entail very much. It's not a program or something. But I don't think it fits really, well, it might sort of fit in some of these categories, yeah. But it'd be shoehorned in. I don't know, I mean, if this is just supposed to be the ones that then would have fees, and if there's anything outside of this doesn't have a fee, or, you know, I just don't, I haven't really thought much about this before, but that was one of the questions I had.
Yeah, Mr. Reed.
I'm wondering if you have a suggestion that would solve the provost's legitimate concern. I mean, it seems like you both have really legitimate concerns, and maybe we ought to put you in a room together and get you to come up with a compromise or a solution. But I'm wondering if you have a solution to this that you think would take care of his concern, but also yours.
Yeah, I guess I'm not really. We've talked about it a lot. We've had a lot of discussion about it. So I'm not really sure what the solution is. Yeah. I know Mad Science has been in. I know Mad Science seems to be one of the things that's the source of concern. And I know Mad Science has been in the schools, and then it has been out of the schools. I know it's been at Bridge Street during their enrichment program. I think it was at Ryan Road at their enrichment program. And then I think for whatever reason, the schools decided to stop. And then, you know, Parks and Rec is now bringing them in. So I get that concern. So I don't know, maybe we should just have a policy. We don't want that particular company, like have it be company specific. Like if the school committee has a concern, a legitimate concern about a company, maybe that should be the rule, that we're just not gonna let that particular company come in. I don't know.
Or that maybe the superintendent has some sort of veto power over this.
That's fine. I think that's always, you know, yeah.
I had actually suggested that, and we were concerned it would open a much larger can of worms, because it seemed to me that if the issue, you know, if someone approaches the school department, we have the right to say we're not comfortable with whatever aspect, whether it's curriculum or the pricing or the fee structure or the sliding scale that's being offered or just their reputation. We can say no, but we don't have that oversight of programs that are offered through. And I said, well, what if we could just veto a program, or we could approve it or not approve it and not have charge the fees? And our concern was that that would actually be even more problematic.
Yeah.
So I don't know what your thoughts are, but it seems like having to seek our approval for programs that are being run, I don't know that that's where you want to go with this either. Don't you think that would be problematic?
Yeah, again, my biggest issue about the fees is that there's a set amount of money in the city budget, and so the fees are going to have to be absorbed somewhere else in the city budget. It's not, because we don't really want to pass it on to the families. That's our other big concern, is part of the Park and Rec Department's mission is to keep the fees low so that families of all incomes can afford the programs. So that's the other issue, is just how we do that. So Dr. Provost wants to respond.
Yeah. I want to totally agree with that. I think that in all of my discussions with Anne Marie, we've wanted to not pass the cost on to families. One of the things that, you know, I come back to when I'm looking at these programs is, according to the analysis that was provided by the Rec Department, they stand to make $29,000 from this. You know, now obviously that's not all profit. They have their own costs of personnel and materials and everything. I don't understand why that cost wouldn't be passed on to them, as it would be if the schools were just bringing them in directly.
So you're saying why they wouldn't pay the rental fee?
Right.
Well, they would. We could certainly charge them the rental fee, and then I think they're going to say it's going to be 130, or, you know, they're going to divide it up among the number of students, and they're going to say, well, it's going to cost $150 to run the course. So. It's going to get passed on. I don't think they're going to, that's the concern that we have. And again, I do think there's plenty of examples where the school department brings in, you know, professional development. I assume those are professionals that are being paid and make money. We bring them in. I don't think we say, oh, and you have to pay rental for the room that you're in. I don't think we charge them rent. I doubt we charge them rent. The College Board is one of the biggest, you know, rackets going, you know, monopoly on the college. And do we charge them rent? I don't know if we charge them rent to use our cafeteria on a Saturday, and they're charging $75 a pop, or however much it is to take the SAT these days, times a bazillion, you know, whatever. Are we getting a cut of that? We certainly have, you know, custodians probably have to be on duty, et cetera. So I just think there's other examples, not just the Parks and Rec Department, that are doing it. And this just feels like you're singling out the Parks and Rec Department. So that's my concern.
Yeah, it seems like when we're talking about...
Molly had a comment.
Yeah, I was just curious, you know, it's one thing to sort of look at these numbers and say, you know, a classroom would be $10 and it's based on a per hour charge. And then I'm flipping through here. I don't know what the math works out to. I mean, it could be a dollar a family.
Well, if you have one of the ones that's just like a 3-hour program, 5 days a week, that's like 15 hours. So that's $150. So if you have 10 kids, then you're going to have to raise the fee $15.
I guess what I'm saying, though, is that I just don't feel like I have all of the, yeah. I can't figure out all of the math.
Yeah.
There's a lot of math between this and this, and I don't know if that's a piece of this to understand in the same way that we understand it for the sports at the high school, for instance, to really break it down and really see what does this look like. And I respect what you're saying about that it also feels targeted. I mean, I'm hearing you, and I'm also feeling like there must have been a reason that this was brought forward, and I don't feel like I'm understanding what it would look like for the Parks Department.
Well, I know, for example, that back to my scenario where if you had 10 kids in that class.
But how many of those classes do they have? I mean, again, like, I just.
Well, they're all there. You can see there's five different sections. There's five classes being offered this summer, five different things, and there's multiple sections. So the Parks and Rec Department would collect $20 per kid from those 10 kids, which would be $200. That would be their administrative charge for those 10 kids. We'd now be paying $150 of that to the schools for the rental of the room. So that would leave them $50 for administrative costs. So in the end, it's going to get subsidized somehow. And I know we don't want to pass it on to the families. We're trying to keep the price low for families. So. Dr. Baird.
I just have a procedural question. It feels like we're getting into this richer discussion or longer discussion that the subcommittee was to avoid that. Can we bring this back to the subcommittee? Because I feel like as a member of the subcommittee, my mind is different. I have more questions, actually. And I feel like we're making, and I might be wrong, but that's why I want to bring it back, that we're making a policy based upon an exception. And I always feel uncomfortable with that. So what is the procedural? What's the role? Can we bring it back to the subcommittee and then bring it with some of these answers or what?
Can you move that at all? Could she move to?
It came to you from the subcommittee, so someone would have to make a motion to send it back to the subcommittee for further study or further discussion.
May I make a motion to bring this, to send this back to the subcommittee?
I was just wondering, was this something that was time sensitive that was actually meant to be implemented before the summer programs were launched, or was this going to take effect for next summer?
Well, the summer programs were launched, the booklets were printed back in January before the fees were put out. So those are
right. I'm just saying, is this time sensitive? We don't even have another subcommittee meeting scheduled. So I'm just wondering if that's an issue for either of you.
I can say that the approval that was given to use the space this year was contingent upon whatever the vote of the school committee was. Now, that was on the assumption that it would probably happen in June and July.
Right.
If it drags out till October, November, December, we may want to say it's not for this year, but when they were given approval to use the schools this year, it was with the understanding the school committee would be considering this, and whatever the vote of the school committee was would be relayed back to the rec department.
Because if this went back to subcommittee, we would have to wait till subcommittee meeting, then we would have to have a first reading again, and then a second reading again, and that would be that scenario where we would move into September, October. Yeah.
At that point, you may want to waive it for this year and do something for next year if it comes to that kind of timeline.
So it's not that I disagree with you, Anne. I'm just saying I think there's a lot now that's involved in it that I wanted us all to think about.
I agree with that, except it feels like it's a more complicated decision than I was feeling it was in the subcommittee meeting. And that I think if we're making a policy change, you know, 4 months down the road. This is me.
I'll be honest, I've struggled with it since the minute we walked out of subcommittee because I my concern is that this price will be added on to students. It will be passed on to the students. Mm-hmm. And we talk about learning loss over the summer being such a big issue, and these programs are important, and they offer financial aid to students up to 50% off for some of these. So I am concerned that it would be passed on to the students, which I think Anne Marie has pledged that she would not do, which means it would come out of the city budget. But I also
which means less money to appropriate to the schools, frankly.
Right.
At the end of the day. So it's all, you know, it's all part of the.
So I don't know that it helps to go back to subcommittee, is what I'm saying. Like,
I think Tom actually.
Sorry, Tom.
So I have three questions that I think are quick. Number one. So right now, Parks and Recreation is paying on column A. Is that what they're paying now?
Because we're a municipal department. Yes.
Okay. And so this would be only for the programs that are commercial that Parks and Recreation is doing, which
science.
Yeah, which are just these Playwell and the Mad Science. Are those the only commercial?
Well, that's the intent, but I'm worried. I don't know how it affects somebody that's just a private contractor who's an aerobics instructor, or who's a swim aerobics instructor, or whatever, who's doing it as a commercial venture.
Yep.
I don't know how that affects them.
Okay. So a follow-up question or query that I throw out there that I don't think we can answer right in this moment is that I know that different robotics and engineering pieces are going on after school or with the robotics club, et cetera. So do we have some capacity to be offering some of this, maybe not all of this, but through the Parks and Recreation, through some of our students doing some of these clubs? So it's rhetorical, I'm just throwing that out there.
I didn't understand.
So we have like the robotics club at the high school, does some outreach to the elementary school, are doing these kinds of clubs after school now, during the school year, some of it through NEF grant. So could there be some capacity built so that our high school students are doing some of these activities with the rec department instead of contracting out through a third party? So I know that can't be answered right now, but I throw that out there. And Mr. Whalen's gone, so maybe Dr. Provost can throw that out there. And then I'm feeling a little uncomfortable with the idea of veto power and how we would decide what groups can come in or can't come in. So the way I read this, any group, so Donald Trump, supporters of Donald Trump want to come in and have a rally at the school. They can come in and do that if they pay the fee, correct? Any group can come in and use the facility as long as they pay the fee. And like the Ward 3 Association, they would still pay the fee. They pay fees to go to Bridge Street?
No, I think they're column A.
They kind of get
it. It's not really holding an event.
And
so I don't really know.
Primarily Northampton residents.
It just feels like it's like there's a lot of unanswered questions. So I love your suggestion, Anne, about having this go back to the subcommittee.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, Mr. Reed.
I just want to understand. So, Candy, this change, this new fee schedule, would not go into effect until we voted for it. So if we send this back to committee, then the old fee schedule remains in effect.
Yes.
Okay.
So that, to me, sort of mollifies the question of timing. And I'm the third person on the Rules and Policy Subcommittee, and I think we're all sort of feeling the same, like, we'd maybe had a longer conversation. And I know at that meeting, Mayor Narkowitz had to leave, and it's making me wonder whether maybe we should meet again, try to meet again soon, and have a complete conversation so that, personally, I want you both to be happy forever.
It's not, it's really not a, yeah, it's, I don't think it's a huge issue. No. For me, it's a, there are city,
happiness.
For me, there are city departments, so I think that that's just my concern. So, yes.
This is a very quick last thing that I'll say about it. I think that the other piece, if you guys go back, because I feel like for me, one of the missing pieces is going back to sort of why this needed to be changed and thinking about entering from that place. Why did this come up as an issue? And then being able, from that sort of core statement, to figure something out. And I'm not certain that I'm understanding that piece.
Should I explain it, or is that what you want us to do?
Go ahead, try.
I think that the way it initially came is that an outside program approached the school department directly and asked permission to run their program here over the summer, and for various reasons they were declined. And that same program then went to the rec department, and they accepted it. And so that program is now being run, and instead of paying the user rate fees from column C that they would have been charged, I think, from
column D or E.
No, because they're for profit. They would be E,
yeah, okay.
But
yeah.
The old, anyway.
Formerly.
Instead of paying the highest rate, they were then paying nothing because they were coming as a program offering from the recreation department, which is a nonprofit, and they do not pay fees.
So is that something about communication between the school and the rec department and saying that there needs to be more communication and say that we had turned this people down?
I guess the school department could certainly coordinate a summer learning enrichment program if they wanted to. They could certainly do that. I'm just saying you could offer these programs yourself and cut out, you know, you could do that, but it would require staff and administration. Ms. Walczak would have to deal with all the registrations and all that, so you would have to do it. So that's what the Parks and Rec Department is doing. So, yeah.
I'll say, for someone who works in a district that does that, we don't want to do that.
Well, some districts do it, some don't. So, Ms. Museum.
Well, it does seem for this organization, then, there might be another solution than charging fees. I mean, if that's really the core of the issue, we're not really talking about then the school system deciding, you know, which programs the Parks and Rec can run and the schools are not, but that if the school has refused to have a program participate, it does seem like it would connect that we would not want Parks and Rec to allow this organization. And we should be able to have some sort of veto power over the in those situations.
Well, I think that that's what's forced us to take a, that forced them to take a look at the policy, that if one program was turned away and then went through and realized, well, I don't have to pay fees if I go through them, the concern was that no one would approach the schools directly anymore. They would say, well, you could do it for free if you go through the rec department as an offering rather than going mm-hmm. directly to the school. I think it was just a loophole that was brought to the forefront by that particular issue.
It's also a really popular program. Kids like it and they sign up for it. So it's a really popular, and I have a list. I mean, it's happening all over the valley. It's happening in Deerfield, it's happening in Hadley, it's happening at schools, East Hampton, it's happening at schools all over the valley this summer. So it's a very attractive, I mean, I've got like a 5-page list of all the different communities that are offering it. So again, it's not, I mean, I don't like the implication that the Parks and Rec Department is like doing this to like, you know, because they're in cahoots trying to help this business make a profit. They're just trying to offer programming that kids want. And, you know.
So why was this program turned?
Well, no, but I'm just saying.
That's my question.
But what I'm saying is
nobody said that.
Okay. But I guess the concern was that the school said, no, we don't want to have you rent the space.
And why was that?
Yeah, I mean, that's the logical next question, that they're trying.
I mean, I thought because there were issues? Well, or I think am I just reading something into
I don't know. You'd
Dr.
Have
Provost? Yeah.
The two issues that were brought to my attention were escaping or not remaining within the space that they had actually signed up for, and concerns about students not being able to access it because of the cost of the program. And so principals had problems with their custodial staff being made to clean up messes that went beyond the scope of the space that we were, in theory, getting a fee to offset the cost of the custodial fees or expenses. And then the other part of the problem was that we were offering a program within our schools that a lot of the kids from the schools couldn't access. There is a scholarship, but it was felt that the scholarship was not enough for a lot of our kids.
Dr. Barry.
Is there a part of the policy? So I guess, again, I'm going to go back to that idea of like the veto and what groups can come in and what groups can't. So is there part of the policy that lays out the process for which we decide, or you decide, or your administrative group decides, yes, we want this group to come in, or no, we don't? Like, I'm not saying those aren't legitimate concerns, mm-hmm. but is there a part of the policy that sets out a procedure for deciding whether or not a group can come in and use it? Because the way I would read this, if I was corporate, or, you know, I would say, well, I can use it as long as I pay the money. You can't turn me down, right?
Well, I do believe that the final authority under the policy rests with the central office, and which is also another concern. I mean, with the four-column structure, there's a great deal of time spent negotiating with all the groups on which column they feel they fit within, which is exacerbated when groups who were first quoted a one-column price end up landing in a different column price.
Because it's community use, though, do we run the risk of being guilty of discrimination if we start saying who can and cannot use community buildings? Why are you looking at me that way?
That's my concern. That's, I guess, what I would...
You're saying who is the authority to veto. I'm saying, is that a legal concern where if we were to say, I'm sorry, this particular political group cannot in fact use our space, or that company cannot, are we opening up ourselves then to even further trouble of discriminatory?
I think that's a public forum question. In terms of allowing or not allowing a group to come in under the fee structure, that, I believe, is not a question of discrimination, because I could be wrong, but I'm not aware of businesses that belong to protected classes.
Okay. And if I hear you right, what you were saying is like you're making decisions based on operational issues.
That's right.
So this is just first reading. Again, welcome to our world. This has just been the discussion. So,
Did you actually make a motion?
No.
There
was
a can I second?
It wasn't seconded.
You can second the motion. It was a motion to refer it back to the committee.
Yeah.
Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions?
Okay, I believe the ayes have it.
So okay, now I'm actually voting. I just realized.
Put in another column.
Five. Okay, the next item on the agenda is the presentation. This is the full reading intervention outcomes presentation that we were waiting for you, Mr. Meyer. We were going to do it last week, but you weren't here, or last month, so we're holding it for you.
Thank you. So going back to the April school committee meeting, Mr. Meyer had asked for a presentation describing the outcomes of the RTI program in terms of the BAS assessment specifically. So, and this presentation addresses that for the first cohort of students, the students who were identified for intervention in the fall and who exited intervention mid-year. We since have completed a second round of intervention. Not all of the students have had an assessment after the second intervention yet, so that data is not included in this. Do you remember which one this is, Laura? Maybe that's going to be the wrong one.
There we go. Okay. So I'll take just a minute to talk about our implementation framework for RTI. There really are three or four parts of the process. The first is to identify candidates through universal screening. We have two measures that we're using in both of the academic areas. In literacy, we're using the BAS, the Benchmark Assessment System, and AIMSWeb measures. In math, we're using a locally grown assessment called the Title I Math Assessment and the AIMSWeb math measures. And for the social-emotional component of the intervention, we're using the Strengths and Difficulties questionnaire. This is a universal screening for all students in elementary school, and the results are then used to make candidate selection determinations. We have decision rules based on the results that students get on any of the screenings. Basically, the decision rules assign a risk number based on how far a child is either below or above the mean for their assessment, and then adds the risk number for the two assessments, if there are two, as is the case with literacy and math. And then students who have the greatest overall risk are selected to go into interventions. The intervention lasts approximately half a year. Intervention is provided on a daily basis for about a half an hour to 40 minutes. And then the final stage in the process is to assess the individual's response to the intervention. In other words, to determine whether or not it worked. So this next slide shows the reason we're using multiple measures, or at least the reason we used multiple measures this past year. I talked about in a prior discussion how no assessment is perfect, and each assessment looks at kids slightly differently. These Venn diagrams represent students who are identified as being at risk either on the BAS or on AIMSWeb in the first, second, and third grade. So you'll see in every case, there's a large group amount of overlap between the AIMSWeb and the BAS. The green is the AIMSWeb and the pink circle is the BAS. And it looks like the correlation gets a little bit tighter as kids get older. But obviously, when we're using a multiple measure system, students who are sitting within both circles are thought to be at higher risk than students who are only within one circle. This next series of graphs shows the results of the fall intervention. These are relative frequency curves. The results are displayed this way because the BAS is called discrete data. It's non-continuous. The difference between an A and a B is not the same as the difference between a B and a C. So you can't perform most of the typical kinds of statistical analysis, but you can look at relative frequencies. So what the graph showing all of these, blue is the fall and red is the winter. The graph shows the percentage of students who fall within that category under the curve. So in the fall, in first grade, a little more than 30% of first graders were at level A. Almost 40%, or say 35% of students were at level B, and then it tailed off from level C, D, and then no one was in level E, F, or G. These are just the students in the intervention, 34 of them. By the winter, you can see that the relative frequency peak where most students were had moved from B to E. We had no students in A or B, which was the most frequent level at the beginning of the intervention. We still had a few students in C, but for the most part, students were level D on over. So I think they made a lot of progress in that intervention. Second grade, looking at the same thing. We had 35 students in the intervention in second grade. They, in the fall, were mostly levels E, F, and G.
And then by the winter, they the peak was level K. Like they dropped off really quickly after level K. So we had a sizable percentage of students in H, I, and J, but almost all of them were from H on up. In third grade, remember I said the difference between levels is not the same. The difference kind of gets wider, I think, as the kids get older. So it's not the same kind of progress, but I think it's still an important demonstration of progress. We had 16 third graders in the intervention. The modal response, if you will, the peak area for them when they were in the fall was level L. By the winter, they had moved over to level N. We still had a few students at level L, but remember, prior to starting this intervention, we had 30% of the students at level K and more than 10% of the students at level J. So I would guess that many of the students in L were from that I and J category who are moving over. So another part of the intervention was not only to prevent learning programs, although that is the, I'm sorry, learning problems, which is the overall vision, it's also to help us identify kids who need more help. One of the things you can do with a response to intervention model is really have a very clear way of identifying kids who are not responding and who need more intensive interventions. So this is looking at, I think this was first graders, maybe second graders, and just plotting all of the curves from beginning to end. You see there was a very clear group of students who started at C and ended at C. Those are the ones who we're worried about. Some information about the efficacy of the intervention. Initially, we had 85 students in grades 1 through 3. 96% of them were below benchmark expectations in the fall. By mid-year, 71% were at or above benchmark expectations. So the improvement range overall was 0 to 8 BAS levels, and the median improvement range was 3 BAS levels. And I'll just add, we've had a stakeholders meeting yesterday or 2 days ago to review the results of the first year of RTI intervention. It was attended by teachers from all four elementary schools. Administrators from several of the elementary schools were present as well. We had some parents of students who were involved in the intervention, and everybody felt the interventions were right on and should be done again. There was a desire to work on the assessment a little more and see if we can streamline it so that less time is spent in the identification process and more time spent in intervention, which I think is a good goal to have, because they saw the results with these kids. You know, they saw these kids who all of which kind of on a path for learning problems. The overwhelming majority are now where they need to be. So I think it was a very effective intervention as measured by BAS. We did also progress measure by AIMSWeb. I showed that to you in the last intervention. We see the same kinds of improvements with the AIMSWeb. The one thing we talked about in terms of progress monitoring is we felt, or many people felt, that AIMSWeb provided a more effective means of providing progress monitoring in between the BAS levels, because some of the BAS levels are pretty large jumps. And it's non-continuous data, so you're either level B or level C. There's no level B and a half. But what some of the other kind of progress monitoring measures did was allow us to show progress for students who, in the midst of the intervention, maybe hadn't gone all the way to C, but we could see by the progress monitoring data we had that they certainly were going to get to C. So that is the report on the initial RTI cohort for literacy. Any questions?
What's the frequency of progress monitoring? Is it weekly?
It depends on the severity of the need. What we go for in the RTI program is monthly progress monitoring. For some kids who are not quite sure that they're making progress, we would increase the frequency of progress monitoring.
And so, I mean, so the point of progress monitoring is to decide if it's effective or not and change course. So are there other programs, like, so for those kids who weren't making growth, were there changes made and they're just still were not making growth, or they weren't making growth and the intervention was continuing but they were just still not making growth?
We've used what's known as the standard treatment protocol model to RTI. And the reason we did that is because when teachers start changing interventions midstream, it becomes really hard to tell whether the students are responders or non-responders because they may be responding to different things. So what we have asked in this program is for students who were in level two to do the level two intervention with fidelity. And then if it doesn't work and they need to go to a tier three intervention, that's the time when we change the intervention.
Okay.
I just want to make a comment. I mean, I think this is some of the most amazing work we can do in this district. I mean, the statistics are so clear about what happens to people, students who aren't reading at grade level by the start of grade four, and they fall off the cliff typically. I mean, it's almost a guarantee of scholastic problems, income problems, dropout rates. And so that K through three window for literacy is so vital. And to get from almost the entire cohort below benchmark in one season to get almost three quarters of them at or above benchmark, you're not just helping students to be readers, you're helping them to be successful in their entire lives, in their school, in work, in graduation, everything. So I just can't applaud you enough for this type of work. I just think it's so great. So thanks.
So even with these results, which are remarkable, there still was a concern that the assessment protocols were taking too much time from classrooms at the beginning or during the assessment period.
Yes.
And Do you see a path forward where you can reduce the time spent in assessment without losing some of the accuracy? That, you know, I mean, you
right. That's the trade-off. It's almost kind of a quantum thing. You know, the faster you do it, the more error you have. Right. You know, if you want to get it perfectly right, then you'll be spending all of your time assessing, and you won't have any time left for intervention. So there are some ideas that I have. One is, we have data that is very fresh now in the spring. We could use that to set up intervention groups right away in the fall. You know, we could skip that fall screening for all but the new students. Another thing we could do is maybe rethink about re-screening kids who've already passed the screen, unless they're showing learning problems. Another thing we could think of doing is doing a two-tiered screen so that we don't screen a kid a second time or with a second measure unless they're showing that they're either below or very weak on the first measure. So there are options we have. And I think that will make many people who are involved with it feel much better about it. Really, the only criticism that I heard in that group yesterday was that it was overwhelming to do this. Not that the results were wrong, not that we had the wrong kids, not that the interventions were wrong or that they didn't grow. Teachers spoke, you know, powerfully about the growth they saw in their kids. They just said, can we figure out a way to do this that involves less assessment?
To carry on the assessment conversation, so there's two tests. My understanding is that one is timed.
Yes.
And one is not.
Yes.
And when you were showing us the Venn diagrams, there are places where both tests cross over. And then there are the places where they show up on the BAS or they show up on the Ames web. do you take the cohort where they're both crossing, or are you taking them wherever they are? If they show up on the BAS or they show up at the Ames Web, you do the intervention?
The reason for developing the risk score was so that we could prioritize students. The students who are, fall within both circles will have the highest risk score, especially if they're really low on both assessments. But we always provided the teachers with exercise of professional discretion. If they felt that there was a reason why the students were scoring low on both measures that was not really directly related to a reading problem, they might be passed over. If it was felt that, for example, the reason the student wasn't performing was because, you know, they were in the midst of a transition in the home, or they were, you know, it was really a second language issue.
Right. I understand that. I guess my question was, why have two tests if we're getting that clump of data and that's the pool of kids that we are drawing from?
Because some of the kids were kids who were only identified by one of the assessments.
Okay. So how long does it take to test?
That is a question that varies from school to school. It's one of the things we learned in yesterday or 2 days ago stakeholder evaluation. Schools had different teams and had different processes for doing the assessment. At some schools, I think it was relatively efficient and was able to be completed in a day or two. At other schools, it was not as efficient. And even if the teachers themselves weren't involved in doing the assessments, they were concerned about disruption to their class as someone was bringing the kids in and out for assessments.
So two more quick follow-ups. So if I'm a student in first grade, how long am I taking a test? Like how much time does it take for me to take it?
Well, the test that takes the most time to administer is the BAS, because that is a test where you keep going until you get the ceiling, you know. That's an assessment that could take more than an hour. Yeah, the other assessments are more or less 5-minute type assessments. Of course, if you on the BAS, if you hit your ceiling immediately, then it can be a very short test.
So, okay, and then what kind of costs do we have for doing these tests?
The Ames Web assessment is a district-wide license. I'm not sure how much we pay for that.
That's a yearly cost. We pay that every year.
Yeah, that's a yearly cost. The BAS assessment is the cost of the testing materials that we purchase as part of our reading program. That already was a cost for the district. It's one of the assessments that's built into our readers and writers workshop. So it's not a new assessment, but it is an ongoing cost, or new cost, but an ongoing cost.
And are any considerations about whether or not to retest a kid later in the year? Like, so if you have a kid who's already scoring high and you know it doesn't really need intervention, I can't see a reason to test them again, unless what I've seen happen, and I don't know if it's happening in Northampton, it's part of your goals as a teacher, as part of your evaluation. So is that part of the discussion?
No, what the discussion around that was that our experience in the first year was that students who passed the screen the first time around were still passing it the second and third time around.
Right.
You know, the instructional reason for re-screening in RTI is because you're worried that some kids might fall through the cracks. But our experience was that kids did not fall through the cracks. You're welcome.
That was coming. Okay, so the next items on the agenda are a votes on two resolutions, and first is a resolution that's being offered by Ms. Hennessy entitled Indigenous Peoples Day.
Recognizing the second Monday of October as an Indigenous Peoples Day.
Okay. And so I guess.
Shall I just?
Would you like to go ahead and read it?
Sure. I will say that this was adapted by the City Council June 2nd meeting. So I'll read the whole thing. Yeah.
Sure.
Okay. If you'd like. So whereas the Northampton School Committee recognizes that the Indigenous peoples of the lands that would later become known as the Americas have occupied these lands since time immemorial, and whereas the Northampton School Committee recognizes that Northampton is built upon the ancestral homelands and villages of the Indigenous peoples of this region, without whom the building of the city would not have been possible, to wit, from the Mohegan tribe, the Nipmucks and the Pequots, and from the Mohegan tribe and Pocumtucks, who established the village of Nahuatuck or Nahnatuck, upon which much present-day Northampton is situated. And whereas the Northampton School Committee wishes to uplift the Indigenous roots of history and contributions to our city and this country, whereas the Northampton School Committee is committed to respecting and protecting the full range of human rights as set forth in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and numerous other international human rights treaties, and whereas the Northampton School Committee, in an effort to promote truth, healing, reconciliation, redress, and justices, acknowledges the ongoing trauma and historical harms, acts of genocide, and violations of the human rights of the Native American, Alaska Native, and other American Indigenous peoples, and whereas the Northampton School Committee has a responsibility to oppose the systematic racism toward Indigenous people in the United States, which perpetuates their income, health, educational, and social inequality, and whereas despite the fact that the federal government guaranteed the health, safety, and welfare of tribal nations in exchange for over 450 million acres of tribal land, American Indian and Alaska Native citizens experience higher disease rates, lower life expectancy rates, higher dropout rates, and higher poverty rates than any other racial or ethnic group in the country. And whereas the median income of American Indian and Alaska Native households is 70% of the median income of all U.S. households, 28.4% of American Indians and Alaska Natives lives in poverty, compared to 15.3% of Americans as a whole. And whereas American Indians and Alaska Natives have a life expectancy that is 4.2 years less than all other races in the United States and die at higher rates than other Americans from many diseases and harms, including chronic liver disease and cirrhosis, diabetes, assault, and homicide, and intentional self-harm and suicide. And whereas the data from the National Center for Education Statistics shows that on average less than 50% of American Indian and Alaska Native students graduate from high school. And whereas the Northampton School Committee understands that in order to help close the equity gap, government entities, organizations, and other public institutions should change their policies and practices to better reflect and significantly improve the experiences and outcomes of American Indian people. And whereas the idea of Indigenous Peoples Day was first proposed in 1977 by a delegation of Native nations to the United Nations sponsored International Conference on Discrimination Against Indigenous Populations in the Americas. And whereas in 1990, representatives from 120 indigenous nations at the First Continental Conference on 500 Years of Indian Resistance unanimously passed a resolution to transform Columbus Day into an occasion to strengthen the process of continental unity and struggle towards liberation, and thereby use the occasion to reveal a more accurate historical record. And whereas the United States federal government, the state of Massachusetts, and the city of Northampton recognized Columbus Day on the second Monday of October in accordance with the federal holiday established in 1937. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the School Committee of Northampton, Massachusetts, one, hereby proclaims that the second Monday in October each month will be known as Indigenous Peoples Day, and two, celebrates and honors the foundational contributions of Indigenous people to the history of our city, the state of Massachusetts, and our country, and three, uses Indigenous Peoples Day as a point from which to, throughout the year, reflect upon and learn about the historical abuses and continuing struggles of Indigenous nations, and to celebrate the magnificent foundations of the Indigenous people of this land upon which our city, state, and country were built, and four, shall continue to promote racial, economic, educational, health, and social equity and justice for all people, and oppose discrimination towards Indigenous peoples as it is perpetuated through inequities in income, health, and education. This resolution, as I said before, was adapted from that which was passed by the Northampton City Council on June 2nd, 2016, which at that meeting, some Northampton school members, teachers, and students also spoke.
Okay. Can I accept that as a motion to move that resolution for?
Second.
And there's a second.
Okay.
Discussion?
Comments?
Ms. Fallon?
So I absolutely support it, but I feel very uncomfortable as a school committee member dictating holidays that we are celebrating to the community without asking for their input. We have community members of Polish heritage that celebrate the Pulaski Day Parade that day. We have community members that celebrate El Dia de la Raza. I feel like it's something that I would like to not be the one making that decision. I don't think that, I understand that our curriculum already reflects these changes. They are being taught the curriculum, how important the indigenous population was, and they're learning all about our local history, especially in third grade. But I don't feel like it's the school committee's place to rename holidays. I understand it's just...
We're not renaming it.
Well, you know what I'm saying.
Well, no, actually, we're not renaming it. We're adding it. So we're not saying we're taking away Columbus Day. We're adding Indigenous Peoples Day.
So you're adding it.
Yep, we're adding it as recognizing as well as.
Oh, okay.
So we're not taking away a holiday.
That's a little bit of a difference.
Yeah,
okay.
I agree with you on that. We're not taking away Columbus Day, nor are we making a statement on that. We're saying we want to recognize this.
Zuhowski?
Yeah, I think it's a good point. Being a Zuhowski, you know, and knowing that for me in Northampton, Columbus Day was always known as Kashmir Pulaski Parade Day. I totally understand that if that was to be threatened and taken away, for me as a Northampton person, that would probably affect me differently. But as Ms. Hennessy said, this would be an additional type of recognition. Also being a Italian-American, I know that Columbus Day started back in the late 1880s in New York City and San Francisco as a way to celebrate Italian-American heritage. And I think the parade down in New York City brings in over 1 million people on Columbus Day to celebrate just that, Italian-American heritage. So there are a lot of things that are being celebrated on the second Monday of the year already. I think bringing this in as something else for us to look at is a good thing, and I'm pleased that it's an addition to and not in place of type of celebration, and bring greater awareness to the Indigenous people, especially right here in the Pioneer Valley and in Northampton. I come from a family of farmers, and one of the greatest collections I have is from my grandfather tilling the fields down in the local meadows in a great set of arrowheads that he's collected. And every time I look at them on my shelf at home, I'm reminded that the land wasn't first ours, it was someone else's, and how grateful I am to now be able to live here in Northampton. But I also know that there were many that were here before me that I have to pay respect towards. So thank you.
Other questions? Sure. Yes.
Will it show up on our school calendar then? Will it say Columbus Day and Indigenous? I would
That would be within the school committee's purview. My expectation is that if this passed, I would bring forward an amended school calendar. We'll have to amend it anyways because the state hasn't determined when testing dates for next year are yet. So that'll be forthcoming at any rate.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions about this? Okay. So all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, please say no. Any abstentions? Okay, so that is adopted. Okay, the next item on the agenda is another resolution. This is a resolution against lifting the cap on Commonwealth charter schools. It's being presented by Ms. Burnham. And if you'd like, I would defer to you to read the resolution.
Terrific. Resolution against lifting the cap on Commonwealth charter schools. Whereas free public schools available to all students, regardless of income, ability, need, or English language proficiency, are foundational to our democracy. And whereas all of our students deserve high-quality public schools that teach the whole child, providing enrichment and addressing social and emotional needs in addition to core academic subjects. And whereas local accountability for our public schools is necessary to ensure that schools are responsive to the needs of their communities. And whereas Northampton is losing $2,086,061 to Commonwealth charter schools, and public school districts across the state are losing more than $408 million this year alone, a loss of funds that is undermining the ability of districts to provide all students with the educational services to which they are entitled. And whereas Commonwealth charter schools are often approved over the objections of a majority of community residents and their elected officials and are not accountable to local elected officials once they are approved. And whereas Commonwealth charter schools often fail to serve the same proportion of special needs students, low-income students, and English language learners as the districts from which they receive students, and often use high suspension rates to drive out students they don't want to serve. And whereas the Commonwealth charter school system is creating separate and unequal opportunities for success. And whereas lifting the cap on charter schools would greatly worsen the problems listed above and lead to a costly and divisive two-track school system. Therefore, be it resolved that the Northampton School Committee opposes lifting the cap on Commonwealth charter schools.
Okay, so I'll accept that as a motion to put that forward. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. May I say it's also great to hear other people have to read the whereases for I'm the one stuck reading them all, so nice you all get to have a turn. Who would like to start? Dr. Baird?
Sure. Go ahead. So I just want to reiterate that $2,086,061 that the Northampton schools loses to charter schools this year, and it's amazing to imagine what we could do if we're still within the district, with those students still within the district. My feeling is we're stronger together than divided. We created a two-tier system. It's just, it's not equitable for all the reasons that are in the resolution. I think it's great that we're gonna take a public stand on this, but it's frankly not enough. I was fortunate to attend the Democratic State Convention with the mayor this last weekend. There are lots of gold and blue signs. People who are politically paying attention understand this, I think, but we need to talk to our neighbors, we need to talk to our families, we need to make sure that people understand why it's so important to vote no on this. It's not enough to just take this vote together as a committee. We really need people to get out there and talk to their neighbors.
Tennessee?
Well, I didn't, but I'll say it. I do think it's, I love this, and I think it's incumbent upon us to continue this discussion and make sure people are understanding both the financial and social impact of the charter schools. I love that you brought it up, and I love the mayor. You're going to be part of that, right, June 22nd meeting?
And the superintendent.
Superintendent. I mean, I think that's, we have to keep doing that, so it's great.
Anyone else like to speak to this? Excellent. Thank you for bringing this forward. Obviously, the timing is good because we're going into the fall season. This is going to be debated. So, all those in favor of adopting the resolution, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So that is adopted. The next item on the agenda is a vote. This is a gift to accept 16 used iMac computers from Smith College. And I'll turn this over to Ms. Walczak.
Yes, these 16 computers are estimated to have a value of about $6,000, and they'll be divided at the high school between the technology, theater, and science departments. And this is just one more in a long line of gifts that Smith College has donated to the public schools.
Make a motion to accept the gift from Smith College of 16 used iMac computers to Northampton High School.
Is there a second?
Second, and I'd just like to point out that at this point, assuming that we approve this, that we'd be tonight accepting $84,683 total in gifts with appreciations.
Okay. Should we make you write the thank you notes or something?
I'd be happy to.
Official
collector of that.
Okay, so there's been a motion made and seconded. Any discussion further? Okay, hearing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so those new used iMacs are gratefully accepted. Next item is a vote to refer a request from the Northampton Association of School Committee employees for full-time release from teaching for association president to the negotiating subcommittee. So this would be a vote to refer that written request to that subcommittee. May I have a motion?
I'll make a motion to refer NACE request for full-time release for teaching for association president to the negotiating subcommittee.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Next is a vote to authorize the superintendent to execute a short-term lease with Northampton Community Television.
I'm not sure if we need that one. We're waiting to hear back from Alan this afternoon.
Okay. Did you hear back from... We haven't heard.
I didn't get a final confirmation, but it appeared from his initial email from Attorney Seawald that it's not necessary to have the superintendent sign the contract. The contract would just be signed by the mayor.
Okay. Okay. So I guess we can hold off on this one for now. Okay. NCTV's lease has expired, so there's a little more time. Doesn't matter. They'll be good. love them. let's see. Bid award. This is a vote to bid award the NHS energy management system upgrades. Ms. Walsh.
Yes, this is an ongoing capital project that's been going on for a couple of years. This is considered phase three of the project. And the only bid that was received on this was from Automated Logic LLC in the amount of $103,249. And Central Service is recommending that we make the award to Automated Logic.
Make a motion to award the bid to NHS Energy Management System Upgrades.
Second.
Okay, second. Any questions or...
Yes. Is this the final phase?
I don't believe so.
Oh.
Sorry.
Any other questions? Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Next is a vote to grant the superintendent budget transfer authority to close out the FY16 books.
This is routine. We do this each June so that if we have to make any budget transfers before we close the books out to hopefully a zero balance on June 30th, we'll have the authorization to do those without waiting for another school committee meeting.
Okay.
Make a motion to grant superintendent budget transfer authority to close the FY16 books.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Next is the business administrator's report and the personnel report.
Okay. Again, you've got your monthly Munich report there. We pretty much see the same areas in deficit that we've been dealing with all year. The good news that based on the latest review of the budget, we will be able to cover all of those deficits with monies left in other areas of the budget through transfers. And the appropriation report this month does show an increase in our appropriation of the $32,000, which reflects the E-rate monies that were transferred to us by the mayor and the city council. Also mentioned that we appear to be in good shape on the school choice and circuit breaker accounts, which are the two largest revolving accounts that we deal with. They fund substantial parts of our budget, and those are looking good for this year also. And then the gifts that we have for this month. From the PTO, we have four gifts. At JFK, the PTO funded a $300 donation for an eighth grade reading trip and a $400 donation for an eighth grade French trip. Both of those donations are deposited into the student activity account because they're actually supplementing monies that the students paid or fundraised for those trips. Then at Jackson Street, we have the rental of a water slide that was paid by the PTO directly for the field day that has a value of approximately $400. And then at Bridge Street, we have the PTO paying directly for the rental of an inflatable water slide there also, and an obstacle course with for a value of just under $900. Then gifts this month from other groups outside of the PTO. At JFK, there was a donation from the Heart of the Valley Chorus to the music program in the amount of $350. At NHS, there was a gift from Target, part of the Take Charge of Education Rewards Program, and that there were actually two checks, and they totaled $326 approximately. At Bridge Street School, there was also a Take Charge of Education donation in the amount of approximately $62. These all have pennies involved with them, from Target. And then also from Jeff Pollitt for the field day at the school, there was a donation from him for the food that our food service program prepared that day, but he donated the food, which had a value of approximately $600. And personnel report, no questions on that. The personnel report is also very short. We had some of the usual turnover and substitutes, and then other than that, we only had one separation. The Paul McNeil, our prevention coalition coordinator, resigned to take another position in the field.
Any other questions about that? Okay. So we'll now move to, actually first, a public disclosure by the superintendent.
Thank you. This actually goes back to the gifts. One of the roles that I have to do under your policies is ensure that when a inflatable company is used by the district, the inflatable company has the appropriate insurance. While reviewing that, I realized that the Jackson Street PTO had rented an inflatable from Party Patrol, which is the company my son works for in the summer. So I don't believe there is any conflict, but in case a reasonable person might infer a conflict of interest, I'm just disclosing that publicly. I'll also preview that I learned after the agenda was set that the Teacher Union Reform Network has awarded a grant to the district for a team of teachers to attend their summer conference. I will be signing the legitimate public purpose forms for all of the teachers. At the next meeting, I'll bring you a legitimate public purpose form for myself, asking your determination on that, because the cost of travel is obviously more than $50.
Okay. Next is a vote to authorize the superintendent to carry over vacation days from FY16 into FY17.
Make a motion to authorize superintendent to carry over vacation days to FY17.
Okay.
Second.
Is there any questions, Ms. Fallon?
Is there a way to amend it that he's actually expected to take vacation days? Just to kind of increase his lifespan and his energy levels.
Healthy relationship with his family. Things that decrease we expect burnout from our teachers.
Maybe some mandatory bounce house.
Water slide. Come to Jackson Street School tomorrow.
We're done.
Actually, my only legitimate concern on this would be a whole lot of days, and if you were to take them consecutively, that would be like a month and a half.
Well, I will point out that my contract only allows me to carry over 10 of the days. So 10 of the days will have to be used between now and the end of the year, or burned. So I'll most likely be burned.
Use them.
Okay. So any further discussion on this motion? Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So duly authorized. Bounce house away. Superintendent's report.
Thank you. This is such a dangerous time of the year to try to attempt to offer individual congratulations. In recent weeks, so much has been achieved by so many in so many domains, from academics to athletics to the creative arts. If I attempted to mention them all, I would surely fail. And even so, I'm sure I'd need a vote from the committee to suspend the rules so that I could get to the end of the list. So I'm going to limit my recognition to a single noteworthy achievement that I want to make you and the community aware of. This year, the Northampton Public Schools will be sending not one, but two teachers to the State House to receive Excellence in Teaching Awards. Put another way, more than 10% of the teachers in the state receiving Excellence Awards this year will come from Northampton. Put another way, Northampton High School will have more award winners than any other whole district in Massachusetts, with the sole exception of Boston, which is a little bit bigger than Hamp High. So I'd like to recognize and congratulate our two award-winning teachers, Rachel Stavely Hale, who will be recognized as a semifinalist for the Massachusetts Teacher of the Year Award, and Kate Dollard, who will be recognized as a finalist for the Presidential Award for Excellence in Mathematics and Science Teaching. With the two exceptions of Rachel and Kate, I want to focus my report on our collective work rather than individual achievement. And I want to focus specifically on the areas of increased voice and agency, because we're doing something new here that has never been done in any district I've worked for. And I think it has the potential to be liberating and transformative. A little less than a year ago, the school committee and NACE negotiated an agreement to use educator feedback. Under this system, students will provide feedback to teachers, teachers will provide feedback to administrators, and administrators will provide feedback for me. Many of us have already deployed the feedback for tool of our choosing. For the rest of us, it's something that remains on the end of year checklist. I've spoken to many of my colleagues who've already gotten feedback from either their students or their teachers, and many have described it as a very powerful and sometimes difficult experience. Many of them have said that it's a very authentic form of feedback, and many have said that it's motivated them to make almost immediate adjustments to their practice. Ralph Tyler, who many consider the grandfather of curriculum design, reminds us constantly that, quote, the need to validate indirect measures against the indicators of the trait of interest. So if the trait of interest is good teaching or good leadership, who could provide a more direct indicator than the students being taught or the teachers being led? I can't tell you how it feels from the other side. I'm the only person in the district who doesn't get to provide feedback. Mr. Meyer asked me if there is a way to provide feedback to the committee, and I haven't figured that one out yet, because I don't know how you can anonymously gather data from all the superintendents you supervise. But for those not in my predicament, I hope this opportunity to provide feedback is also some kind of a validation. Placing the evaluation shoe on the other foot, so to speak, when the teacher to student and teacher to administrator relationship is strong, there's a sense of mutual responsibility and mutual liability. Both sides are accountable to each other. My hope is that our new educator feedback process will provide a structure for two-way accountable communication that will help us all to become better students, teachers, and leaders. I know that the feedback I received definitely was helpful for me. It's something I'll be discussing with my evaluation committee. And that's my report.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Provost. We have no business scheduled for this evening. We do have some future business and meeting dates to announce. The negotiating subcommittee will meet on June 13, 2016, at 3:15 p.m. at JFK. And the superintendent evaluation team will meet June 27th at 10 a.m. in the superintendent's office. And then our next school committee meeting is July 14, 2016, at 7:15 p.m. in JFK. We do have a request for an executive session in the JFK principal's conference room. And I would ask the vice chair if he would make that motion and request.
Okay, I make a motion to request for an executive session in the JFK Principal's Conference Room under Massachusetts General Law for the approval of executive session minutes May 11th, May 18th, and May 23rd, 2016 in Chapter 30A, Section 21A3 to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining, whereas an open session would have a detrimental effect and further details would compromise the reason for going into executive session.
Okay, so there's been a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. I now would like, need a roll call vote. This is a yes, yay or nay vote. And I'll ask the clerk to call the roll.
Yeah, yay.
Yes. Yay. Yay. It's already 5:30. I'm.
Yay.
Yes.
Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
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 Yay. Okay, so I do have to let the public know that we are now moving into an executive session, because to have this discussion in open session would be detrimental to the reasons for going into an executive session. I also need to inform the public that we will adjourn from executive session. We will not return to open session. So with that, we will now move into executive session.